Thank you and welcome to the show this morning. The topic this morning is challenges of African-American youth. And we have with us to talk about some of the challenges of African-American youth, Minister Gregory Taylor. Minister Taylor has been with us on a number of occasions, and today he has agreed to talk about some of the challenges of African-American youth and some of the ways that they might be able to overcome some of the challenges that they face. And of course, Brother Taylor, let me welcome you to the show this morning.
Thank you.
And let me tell you how delighted we are to have you here.
Thank you.
And to let our audience know that not only have you been with us before, but you've given us excellent information each time that you come.
Thank you.
So before we start, let's have you to give us some information in reference to your background,
okay,
your education,
yes,
and some of your experiences, and take about 6 minutes in reference,
okay,
to doing that.
Okay.
Then we'll have a first commercial break for 2 minutes, and then we'll come back for 8 minutes and deal more specifically with what we consider to be some of the challenges of African-American youth today.
Yes, yes.
Let's start off that,
okay,
way.
Well, my name is Gregory Taylor, and I'm from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, a little town called Northport. And I went to school at Selman University, and I went to graduate school at Virginia Union. I didn't finish there, but I did go. And today I have become, along with working with the estate of Sir J. Robert Bradley, I'm an ambassador for the Civilian Conservation Corps, which is an excellent program that came about in the 50s, I mean in the 30s,
30s.
Yeah, in the 30s, by FDR to reach out to the young men who were sons of the Depression. And so I am a son of the Depression, and I think that what's most appropriate here today when I think of young people, one of the experiences of my own, my mother was hungry and pregnant with me. And when she fixed my lunch for kindergarten, she would fix me a banana, potato chip, and chocolate milk. And I would sit there until it was time to eat. I didn't do anything else. And the reason I'm saying this in this introduction is I'm a product of what I'm talking about. That our kids today, which don't have food, how it affects them in the classroom, trying to study, wondering where the next meal is going to come from. All of those things affects their concentration. And I'm speaking from my own experiences, but I had food, but I still couldn't concentrate in school because I didn't learn my ABCs until about fourth grade or something like that. So these are the kind of things that are going on here. And a lot of the things that happened, T. Barry Brazeton said that what happens after birth is a direct correlation to what happens before birth. And Dr. Alvin Poussant and the lady over the Children of Defense Fund said that our kids today are being prepared in prenatal for prison. And this is true. And so this is the general subject area where we are coming from and speaking about, you know, today. And those are the areas of, in school, I forget about this. I have written a book and it's entitled Unrefined Thoughts for Thinking for Learning. This book is about my struggle in school and learning to read. And I'll never forget, I was presenting it in class one day, and this little girl said that she had never heard any material like mine written before, and that she had stopped learning because she was not learning like the other kids in the classroom. And what intrigued her the most about what I had to say was when the teacher would ask us if we comprehend something that they had read in the book. And Dr. Haney, I would say, comprehend? What is that? I thought it was a cloud or something supposed to appear in my face, my book, with the answer in my face or something like that. But I opened up and didn't mind sharing with those who were learning to read my unorthodox way of learning, or thoughts that I would not share as a kid in school because they put me, think they put me in a special education class or something like that. And one of the other things in the book by Fabre, it says, how to talk so kids will listen, and listen so kids will talk. Yeah, and it said that a child may not know how to tell you how you made them feel, but they know how to feel. And so that was one of the things for me in kindergarten. I was afraid of the teacher's voice, so I quit, you know. And then when my mother was teaching me how to read the Bible, when she couldn't pronounce a word, I was made to feel guilty. But as an adult, I learned that she didn't know phonics, you know. And so these are things that teachers have got to open up. Like a lot of teachers who are certificated, they're not certified. you know, they can teach, you know, the lesson from the book and things of this nature.
So they have a certificate, but they have no certification.
That's right.
In terms of the ability to be able to deliver the information.